Thank you very much for invitation to give a talk. First, I thought that maybe my talk would be too far from the mainstream of the workshop, but now it's not too far, closer than I thought a priori at least. Okay, so I will talk about, actually I'm at the moment I'm unable to change the pages, so we'll speak first and maybe he will bring remote control and then we'll continue. Well, anyway, I will start with a short introduction. So we consider stratifications. So in general, stratification of a say variety is a disjoint union of its subsets called strata. The strata usually are supposed to have some properties like smoothness, irreducibility, or whatever. And usually some extra properties are imposed. Okay, so I need to then. Okay, so like this. Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so.
Point that.
Не работает это все. Не работает. Да, да, да. А, вот это есть. А, хорошо. Нет, не работает это. Переключалка, страница. Хорошо. Okay, so thank you. Usually some extra conditions of adjacency between the strata are imposed, like Tom or Whitney conditions. And as Kolemnev mentioned in his talk yesterday, there is a natural partial relation between the stratifications. Say if you have a stratification, you can consider a subdivision of a strata. Then a new finer stratification is called refinement, and respectively the former stratification is called coarser of the latter. And the question is whether also Kolya in his talk considered this question, whether there is universal stratification, so the coarsest in this sense. In other words, that any other stratification is a subdivision of this universal. And well, because this notion, there was a vague understanding that universal stratification do not always exist, but there were no means to prove that. And we propose such means in for a class of, so first of all you need to fix a class of stratifications, and that's what I will do a little bit later. And in this class of stratifications we study the question whether is this universal one, and we'll answer this question. So we'll give a criterion whether when such a universal stratification does exist in terms of dual bundles of vector spaces for this variety. And in particular, this will allow us a possibility to construct an example of a variety when a universal stratification, which doesn't admit a universal stratification. But definitely the criterion itself is much more interesting and important. Well, actually the motivation for the whole study was of course the question from complexity, still open problem, what is the complexity of stratifications? I will also discuss it in a few minutes. I will consider mainly the complex algebraic varieties, but in fact the whole theory can be extended to say real algebraic varieties or to analytic varieties or to real analytic varieties. And also instead of complex field one can extend it to any algebraically closed field of zero characteristic just by Tarski principle. Okay, so just to remind the basic notions. So and introduce notations. So SI are strata, and we'll just as I said, usually we assume that the strata are smooth, reducible, open and closed, and so on. So in addition, satisfy the conditions of Whitney and Tom type. Okay, so that means that we fix some class of certification, which I'll do actually in the next slide. And now more precise definition of this relation of coarseness. Actually, what we need, it is not just exactly we consider subdivision of strata, but we require that. So we say that stratification R is finer than stratification SI if for each strata, for each stratum SI, there exists such stratum RJ such that the intersection is dense in both SI and RJ. Well, definitely such
strata.
No. So it's not symmetric. No. For such I, there exists J. If in inverse, then they're equivalent. In fact, yeah. So it's okay. So informally, one can say that that what we discussed before, that SI is coarser than each stratum is a subdivision. But in fact, it's more precise. More precise definition is necessary. Okay, and clearly, if such J does exist, it is unique due to the properties of the risky topology. Okay, and we say that stratification is universal in a fixed class of stratification if it is the coarsest in this class. Well, for complexity needs, the use of universal stratification is that if it does exist, you can in a natural way define the complexity of a variety intrinsically as sum of the degrees of the strata. Okay, and now I remind actually Whitney and Tom conditions. I will talk only about Whitney A condition. There is, perhaps you know, that there is also a stronger Whitney B condition. But unfortunately, we were unable to express Whitney B condition in terms of the dual bundles. And that's why we restrict ourselves by Whitney A condition. So actually, it's an interesting problem how to you will see later what are the bundles we consider, how to express big Whitney B condition in these terms. Okay, so we say that stratification fulfills Whitney A condition if for any sequence of points from some strata SI with a limit from in another strata perhaps SJ. And also we assume that the limit of tangent spaces does exist. Then we state that this limit contains the tangent space of this strata Sj, to which point x belongs at this point x. And Whitney proved that any variety, actually in general setting, in algebraic, analytic, and real, whatever, it admits a stratification satisfying Whitney A and actually Whitney B condition. Well, okay, now I remind Tom condition. So assume that we have a polynomial, but again, one can talk about analytic function, or actually one can talk about maps, polynomial maps or analytic maps. And we assume that zero is a critical value of it. And we say that a stratification of the set of critical points fulfills Thom condition if for any sequence of points. Now I draw your attention that we consider the points in the embined space, in the whole embined space. Okay, so they have some limit, we assume. Limit belongs to stratification to the stratum Si, and we also assume that the limit of the gradient does exist. Then the statement is that this limit is orthogonal to the tangent plane at the point x to Si. And Hironaka proved that, again, it's for a polynomial or for any analytic function, there exists a stratification with a Thom condition. Here in this theorem, it is essential that the image is one-dimensional. It is a well-known example. That if you consider for in the mapping in the two-dimensional space, say of the standard blow up, this map doesn't admit a Thom stratification. So it is indeed essential that you the image is one-dimensional. Okay, then what next I need to remind, what is the Gauss map? So Gauss map, it sends one can define in a constructible set, sends each non-singular point to the tangent space at this point. And we say that, S is Gauss regular if Gauss map can be extended continuously on the whole S. Well, clearly, if there is extension, continuous extension, then it is unique. Clearly, also that if S is smooth, then it is Gauss regular, but not vice versa. Say if you consider a cusp, then it is Gauss regular. Because this condition actually means that if you consider tangents close to zero, then the limit when the point tends to zero is unique. But still the curve is not smooth at the zero point. Okay, thus we fix the class of stratification which we'll deal with. So it would be its strata would be Gauss regular, so it is a difference with the standard setting when usually strata are supposed to be smooth. So we weaken a little bit the condition of smoothness to Gauss regular by technical reasons. Also, we'll assume that stratification will satisfy Whitney A and Thom conditions. So from now on, we fix this class. And the question which we deal with when the point of the set of critical points admits a universal stratification. Okay. So I start with a very useful tool, which is surprisingly not widespread. It's called the Gleason closure of a bundle of vector spaces. So assume that you have some set in the product of variety by vector space, and you want to construct the minimal closed bundle of vector spaces spaces which contains Q. And that gives the Gleason construction. Gleason was actually a French mathematician. Construction was, I think, was done in 1958. and surprisingly not well spread. Okay, so what we do? It's a recursive construction. First we consider the following bundle of vector spaces Q1. So we start with Q and then proceed to Q1. Its fiber is the linear hull of the closure of Q. In other words, we first take the closure of Q and then take its fibers at each point. So take fix V from the base and then all the points from the fiber W. And then perhaps it is not a linear space.
It is not a
Actually, this completely doesn't matter. It's just a subset. It's very abstract construction. And then, perhaps this fiber is not linear. Then we take its linear hull. So we take a linear hull pointwise, in other words. And this gives you a bundle of vector spaces Q1. But perhaps it is not closed. Then we repeat this construction and applying it to Q1. So again, take its closure. Then for each point in the base, we take the fiber. Then its linear hull and get Q2 and so on. In this way, we get an increasing chain of bundles. Q1, Q2, Q2, so on. And this chain stabilizes quite soon, and at most two times dimension of W iterations. After that, doesn't increase anymore. And the resulting bundle, it is closed now, closed bundle of vector spaces. It will call it the Glaser closure of Q. This would be bundle V. So it would be indeed the minimal closed bundle of vector spaces which contains Q. And what is important for complexity needs that this construction is constructive. It's quite constructive. Okay, and what we do now? We apply this construction to the set in the two times n dimensional space where the fiber at each point x is the line generated by the gradient of the function f. And the result, it would be actually our main object which we'll deal with, we'll denote it by gf. We restrict it on the critical points and denote it by GF. Okay, and now we proceed to the main construction of which attaches to a stratification a dual bundle of vector spaces. So we start with the stratification of the set of critical points, so with the properties. Which we assumed from our class of stratifications, so with Gauss regular strata, so on, so on, and so we define the bundle in the following way. So its fiber would be just the orthogonal complement of the tangent plane at this point to this strata. So clearly, it depends on the point and surely it depends on the stratum to which it belongs. Well, and in this language of the dual bundles attached to stratification, we are able to express all the necessary properties of stratifications. Namely, first, so stratification satisfies Thom condition if and only if the dual bundle contains our glaze closure GF defined in the previous slide. Okay. So certification satisfies a Whitney A condition if and only if the bundle so defined is closed. Well, by the way, at this point, it's well not clear maybe, but I can comment at least why we do not consider Whitney B condition, because we are unable to express the Whitney B condition in the similar terms. Okay, and finally, moreover, we can express the relation of coarseness of stratifications. So stratification is S is coarser than stratification R, if and only if for the corresponding dual bundles the following inclusion holds. So that means that now we can rephrase completely the question of universal stratification in the language of dual bundles. It is quite helpful for our needs. Okay. In other words, that means that we are looking, so the question of existence of a universal stratification is equivalent to that among the closed dual bundles containing GF, there is the minimal one. Okay. So that's the now our reformulation. And now to give a criterion of existence of the universal stratification, we introduce what we call Lagrangian bundles. So this is in some sense a dual construction to the previous one. So in the previous slide, what we did, we started with some stratification. And to which for this stratification we constructed a dual bundle, and now we do in some sense a converse thing. So we start with the bundle of vector spaces B, and we construct for each. It's not a stratification, but at least some sets which we call temporally quasi-strata. Simply, we consider the sets with the same dimension of its fibers.
We start with function F.
Well, now forget about function F. Now we have a bundle of vector spaces.
Independently.
And we consider a quasi-stratification. So quasi-strata BK with the subscript K is the set of the points in the base such that the dimension of the fiber at this point is K. Just a very, very naive thing we do. And we say, well, if you do it for actually for arbitrary bundle of vector spaces, this construction will give something strange. But assume that the bundle is Lagrangian. That it's only a word. It's only a word. But then you will see that it's really close to the classical Lagrangian manifolds. Okay, we call B Lagrangian because it's really very very close in the flavor what to Lagrangian manifolds. We say that B. So a bundle, closed bundle vector space is Lagrangian if for any Gauss regular point of any strata, the fiber it is the orthogonal complement of the tangent space. Okay. Then.
Uh,
it's a definition for B. So we have just a closed bundle of vector spaces, and we say when it is Lagrangian, when it satisfies this property. So we take a fiber, actually, and then it is the orthogonal complement of the tangent space. Tangent space to this quasi-strata, to this quasi-strata. Okay, this is a very good property of the bundle. Now we'll see that that this is at least a sufficient condition to have a universal stratification. Namely, the following theorem. Okay, if the bundle, so now we come back to, now we remind that we consider the function f, we consider the bundle attached to it, and assume now that this bundle is Lagrangian. Then the claim is that there exists universal stratification of its set of critical points satisfying Wittnerian boom condition. Yes. And now I will show what is this stratification. It is exactly what we considered before. So so this quasi-strata now become indeed strata of this universal stratification. So if G, this bundle, is Lagrangian, then we consider just this quasi-strata, and then will provide us, well, the irreducible components, they will provide us the universal stratification. That's the.
My question was, why universal? Because universal means that.
Universal in this class, in the class which, in class of stratifications which we fixed. So, the strata are Gauss regular, and the stratification satisfies Whitney A and Thom conditions. So in this class of stratifications, it provides you the universal stratification.
And what about F?
For F, we construct by Glaeser closure GF, starting with, say, I repeat, okay, so in general, we start with F. Consider the bundle of gradients of F,
so
then apply
indirect condition on F.
Yes. Yeah, sure.
How strong?
in what language I can answer this question?
In terms of F.
Okay, there at the end, I provide some examples, when it happens and when it doesn't happen. In interesting cases, it is the case, but sometimes it fails. No. There would be a counterexample, that when it is not the case, yeah. But, you know, to answer this question, okay, if you ask about probability or whatever, you should make more precise this terms, yeah. Yes, otherwise there is nothing to stratify. Yeah.
But in general, functions with multi-dimensional critical sets, this is co-dimensional, right?
Yes. Yeah. Well, again, you are right that it's empty, usually. Usually it's empty, yeah. Then this doesn't make sense, yeah, in some sense, the answer. Right. Okay, and moreover, it is really the dual, it's involution. So you start, if G is Lagrangian, then you start with G, you construct this stratification, and then with the previous construction, you start with G, then you construct this quasi-strata, and then you come back to the bundle, and then you come back to bundle G. So this is really duality in the case of only Lagrangian Lagrangian bundles of vector spaces. So, well, this theorem, in some sense, it is forced. It is a matter of proper application of appropriate definitions. But what is much more surprising, that the inverse holds. So that if the set of critical points admits universal stratification, then the bundle GF, our main object, is Lagrangian. It is really a very surprising theorem, and it is the proof is quite technical. It's equivalence. Yeah. No, we say it's equivalence. Yeah. But the path of sufficiency was much. It was natural. The proof was natural, and this is much more technical. And I would not surely give on any details. I will mention maybe one thing. One of the auxiliary results in the proof of this theorem is what we called Bertini-type theorem for singular varieties. Well, it is well-known Bertini's theorem that if you have a non-singular variety that its generic hyperplane intersection is also non-singular. But something you can say also about singular varieties. More precisely for Gauss regular varieties. And that is the part of this theory. So this is really the main result. And now I will formulate one conjecture. We know that GF is not, we don't know yet, but we'll see in the examples that GF is not necessarily Lagrangian. So it's some bundle of vector spaces, but not necessarily Lagrangian. But still, the conjecture is that it surprisingly it works for any examples, despite that for non-Lagrangian, that dimension of each irreducible variety equals n. And that, in some sense, is some justification of the word Lagrangian. Because if it was true, then one could treat GF as a kind of non-smooth analog of Lagrangian manifold. We did not elaborate this. We did not actually think seriously on the conjecture, and we did not elaborate this. Because despite these our results were known long ago, there was no continuation, and somehow there was no encouragement, and so we actually abandoned this research. Okay, and now the issue, the complexity issue, which was actually for me a motivation for the whole study, and the problem is open. What is the complexity of stratification of a variety? So you are given a variety given by some set of polynomials, say even by by a single polynomial or maybe by system polynomials. And what is the complexity? There are easy examples that the complexity is at least in some sense exponential. In two different senses. Complexity of construction, complexities of the algorithm. And secondly, you can do the following. You can consider the strata and consider the sum of its degrees of the strata. It's a measure of complexity in some sense. And the question is, what is this measure? Well, it's easy to construct examples that show that it's at least exponential in general cases. And also the trivial bound is double exponential. And I don't know where is the truth. You see, single exponential or double exponential. For this particular construction, I had a hope that because it's really very Well, look, the main part of the construction is glazer closure, which looks very simple. But unfortunately, well, and it has no, well, and the glazer closure, it has at most, as we discussed, two times n steps. But unfortunately, the reason the complexity of this construction is a priori complexity, upper bound is double exponential, and the reason is the usual reason for such constructions, because you have two times n iterations, but at each iteration the size of your data they can increase by a polynomial, say by a square. And if you repeat it two times n times, then you will get, unfortunately, double exponential function. This is the reason of all this type of constructions. And well, actually, this is again the feature also of the naive construction of stratification. When you can do the following with any variety, actually. You take the variety and consider its singular points. Okay, then it would be the first strata. Then among each, you again distinguish its singular points. Then again, you repeat it, singular of singular, and so on, so on. So you get a clearly naive stratification. It will again stop after n iterations when dimension, because each time dimension drops at least by one, and again this complexity of this construction is again double exponential. And I don't know whether it is there is some intrinsic reason for that, such type of constructions, they always have double exponential, and so it's for me, it's an open question. Not only for. By the way, it's a priori upper bound, so I don't know. Upper bound. It's upper bound. Yeah, it's upper bound. No. That is the first question. For this, you take this particular construction and ask, what is its complexity? Whether it's exponential or double exponential, and for any other type of construction, also for naive one. Yeah, well, and yeah, exactly, and that is the point, that the number of iterations is small.
You know that you wouldn't be able to bound the iteration more?
I don't think that you can get essentially less than n iterations.
With examples, an actual example?
Yes, there is example. Yeah, there is example for the glazer construction, there is example. It's in the paper, I wouldn't present, it's quite complicated, but there is such example, yeah. But unfortunately, I don't know, fortunately or unfortunately, for this particular example, the complexity is small, complexity is exponential. So so far I don't have an example with a double exponential complexity.
It's not clear how the function of polynomial what
its role. You have this bundle.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Phenomenal. it doesn't help. No, in these constructions, it doesn't help. After the first step, you will have a dense polynomial. It doesn't help. You contain the products. What? Okay, you know. It's But how do you represent algorithmically this variety? If you do it by polynomial, it's an in some sense it's an input of the algorithm. But otherwise, how do you represent a variety? Anyway, you need to represent it somehow.
Yeah. It's interesting to make it critical set.
Yes. Okay, this would be another type of result, but it would not answer this question.
Of course, you know,
No, no, it's another interesting question, I agree, yeah. Yeah, well, so anyway, this problem is open, and there were many attempts to solve it. Say by Mostovsky tried to do it, Tadeusz. No, this case without Porushinsky, without Porushinsky, no. It's Mostovsky. And, well, he had interesting results that say, assume that what happens that if in this naive construction you skip some dimensions, and your next stratum is much less dimension. Say you have some number k of such steps, then the complexity would depend on k, so it would be 2 to the power k. So if you are lucky, then say if you are just by chance you have dimension n, and then you drop to dimension 0 immediately, then perfect, then complexity would be polynomial. So something was known, but still it's surprising, this problem. Well, okay, so there are two types of the problem. The easier, in some sense, part is to understand the complexity of this particular algorithm, or of alternatively of the naive algorithm. And the more difficult problem is to understand what is the complexity of the problem for any algorithm. For any type of stratification, for any stratification. Okay, so, and now two examples. First example is okay to make you happy, to show that the picture is nice, and so you have a Lagrangian bundle, and so stratification is universal, whatever. So this is stratification of quadratic forms. Okay, so our polynomial is now a quadratic form, a generic quadratic form in all these variables and coefficients, and both in variables. So totally there are so many variables. Okay, then it's easy to see that critical set is just the zero in axis and arbitrary coefficients. Okay, and it's really very nice calculation that you see that Glaser closure is constructed in a single iteration, and that's it. And it's Lagrangian, so the bundle is Lagrangian, and so we get the following stratification. Actually, it's one can easily guess that it's stratification according to the rank of the quadratic form. Well, and so you get the strata just with a given rank. So here we have the dimension of the fiber. So this would be, you can compute this number, and they so constitute a universal stratification by our theorem. Fine. Okay. Now. Example, what Gainé was interested, variety without universal stratification. Okay, we can see the again quadratic form, but slightly modified. So here you see you have a B square instead of B. And this change is dramatic. You will see on the geometry. Again, we have it now, it's in two variables, so totally we have five variables. So we live in the five-dimensional space.
Consider all such a quadratic form.
No, it's a single quadratic form. It's a single polynomial in five variables. A single polynomial.
In this case, I don't understand why B squared is important. You can define B as B squared.
Surprisingly, it's important. Okay. Well, clearly the set of critical points is again the set where x and y vanish. It's a three-dimensional linear space. And what are the quasi-strata? Okay. So G2, so when the points where the fiber has dimension 2, it is just the points where the rank of the quadratic form is 2. Yeah, it's just for, well, these are for variables and these are for coordinates. Yeah, yeah, it's the same. Yeah. Yeah. G3, where the so where the fiber dimension of fiber is 3, it corresponds to the quadratic forms where the rank is 1. Well, and finally, there is a single zero quadratic form where the fiber dimension of the fiber is 4. And the reason that the dimension of the fiber is 4 gives you that you don't have a non-Lagrangianity. And that's why, by our theorem, it's not a you don't have a this variety f equals to z, it doesn't contain a critical set of f, doesn't admit a universal stratification. Well, so G2 and G3 are Lagrangian. Well, some hint is that this number 2, so the dimension of the fiber plus the dimension of the set itself should be 5, the dimension of the embedding space. Because I remind you that the Lagrangian property is that the fiber is orthogonal complement to the tangent plane. The same is true for G3. It has a dimension 2, and the fiber has a dimension 3. But it fails Lagrangianity for the zero. Its dimension is zero, but its fiber has a dimension 4. And zero is less than 5 minus 4. So this is an example. Yes, in some yes. If it wouldn't be, yeah, in some sense, yes. It's previous slide. It's previous slide.
It no, on, let's take this slide. On this slide.
Okay.
There's three occurrences of B squared.
Yeah. Yeah. Then, okay. Then this would be G5. Then that means that the dimension of the fiber at the zero point would be the whole space, five dimensional space. But with this condition, B squared, you have the dimension 4. It is some subspace of dimension 4.
Nevertheless, you consider all polynomial of this type, not one.
No, it's a it's a single it's a single polynomial with 5 variables.
Yes.
It's a single polynomial with 5 variables.
Of
yes.
Degree of variable methods.
Yeah. Okay, you're right. It's not quadratic form. in some sense. Well, actually, this formally, implication of the theorem. And now I will illustrate this more particularly on this example. I will present two stratifications which are incomparable. You understand?
Yeah.
You can give the second one. Okay. No.
Just no, why you divide this.
Okay. Well, I mean, now this is another, if you wish, it's another proof for this example that it doesn't admit a universal stratification. Okay. So first of all, there is the one. There is one stratification, just G2, G3, and G4. It's a very good stratification with smooth strata. Actually, it's moreover smooth. We need Gauss regular, but it's moreover smooth, satisfying Whitney A and Thom conditions. But there is another stratification. Now we will construct it. Consider the following rational curve. Okay. This curve clearly belongs to G3. Okay, it's easy to check. And so you have another stratification, G2, G3 minus this curve. You pull out this curve and this curve itself. Okay, and this is another stratification. And it's incomparable with this stratification. Okay, and it's incomparable, and moreover, well, if you think that situation is so tight that there cannot be a stratification which is coarser than both. Situation is too tight at the point zero. And so this is another illustration why this variety doesn't, critical set of this variety doesn't admit a universal stratification. Okay, so in the last example, well, actually, this is a strange example. I give it just for historical reasons. I will tell you why at the end. So consider an arbitrary polynomial. And now we, an arbitrary polynomial in, say, n variables. Now we do the following. We again play with this coefficient. We spoil it further. We put here g square for arbitrary polynomial g. Okay, now it's a polynomial in n plus 4 variables, whatever. Well, and again, it has three quasi-strata. Again, according to the rank of the quadratic form, which is not quadratic form. Okay, rank 2, rank 1, and rank 0. No, it's a joke.
Because A, B, C play a role of deformation parameter.
Right. It's another deformation. Yeah,
so
I agree.
In this case, of course, it's important.
Which deformation you consider? Exactly. Yes. So you have three quasi-strata. And the first two quasi-strata are very good, they're Lagrangian, but the last is awful. It could be an arbitrary hypersurface, because it's actually is given in this linear space, it's given by a polynomial G which could be arbitrary. So it can be not Gauss regular, it could be anything what you can imagine. And why I give this crazy example? It contradicts to an original, I can confess that it contradicts to an original conjecture that quasi-strata should be always smooth. So the hope, initial hope, was to have a good construction which is not of the recursive type, say, as a naive construction, but it gives you the strata at once. And that was the hope, but unfortunately, this example shows that it fails. It's very far from to be true. Thank you for your attention.
Just add to the slide that G is not a constant.
Say it again.
What? Add to the slide that G is not a constant.
G is not a constant, yes. Right, you're right. No, I say that it could be not Gauss regular for some G, whatever.
Other questions? So you have some further plans in this way?
There are at least two problems I see, which I mentioned, the complexity of stratifications and this conjecture about the dimension of the reducible components of GF and that. But This result actually is 5 years ago. It was published last year in Advances, but it was obtained 5 years ago, and there was no reaction. And so maybe since people are not interested, we abandoned this. And okay, I do other things. but definitely there is a lot of nice things to continue. If somebody would continue, well, it's a diamond.
We will wish you more popularity of this topic.
Okay.